Hey YouTubers, this is Ambarola1B presenting a film of a documentary of old-time radio, and it's called The Great Radio Comedians. This broadcast was actually originally aired on television in 1972 for PBS, and I remember seeing it when I was a kid during that period, and I really enjoyed it. In fact, I taped the audio from it on a reel-to-reel tape, and I kept it for years and always wanted to see this program again. Well, there used to be this film collector's newspaper, which doesn't exist anymore. It was called The Big Reel, and I found out that it didn't exist anymore because I went online to look for it because I hadn't subscribed to it in years. And I found out they went out of publication, and I was kind of sad about that. But while it was still in publication in the early 90s, I went flipping through a copy of it and found this film. And it was on two reels, and I bought it for $250. The film has turned red, and I don't really have great capabilities to record this film directly off the screen without any flicker, because my projector and the lens on the camera aren't synchronized. So you're going to see some flickering, and you're going to hear the sound of the projector in the background, but I tried to place the loudspeaker as close to the camera as I could, and I actually filmed it off of a window shade in my kitchen as the screen. So it's going to look a little bit weird, but I did get to film the whole thing, and so I am now presenting to you The Great Radio Comedians.
They've insisted that sounds do not die. The vibrations keep traveling through space. Nothing on it yet. And if we have an instrument sensitive enough, we can pick up sounds of the past. This machine will do it.
You don't say.
Yes. Well, don't give us such a long commercial. Just turn it on.
All right, I will.
I think it's this one. We'll do it.
There it is.
Now we listen.
After 20 years in competition with a younger, more attractive medium? The 1950s answered that question, and radio as we had known it virtually disappeared. But when the 1940s began, it was a far different story. This little invention had already changed America. Think of it. For the first time in history, a single voice could speak to the entire population simultaneously. Suddenly, we were all sharing the same telephone party line.
And
was America's most popular art form. Everyone loved it. People arranged their lives so they wouldn't miss their favorite programs. They listened to drama, commentators, music, quiz shows. But the sounds they preferred year after year after year were the voices of the people who made them laugh. The great radio comedians.
It's Maxwell House Coffee Time, starring George Burns and Gracie Allen. With yours truly, Bill Goodwin, and the music of Meredith Wilson and his orchestra.
Gosh, honey, I feel like a damn fool going to college at my age. I dread that first class.
What is your first class?
American history. And I'm terrible. When I should have been studying history, I was in vaudeville.
Oh, I'll bet you're very good in history.
You do, huh? Yesterday, the professor asked, what great American stayed longest in the Capitol? I answered, Al Jolson.
Darling, even I know better than that.
Certainly.
Was Eddie Cannon. You should be proud to be going to college and learning things.
Well, honey, my friends are laughing at me. Last night, the fellows called up and wanted me to go to a burlesque show with them. I had to say, I can't, guys. Haven't finished my homework.
All right. But when you do go to a burlesque show, you'll enjoy it more because you've studied anatomy.
I tell you, honey, I'm too old to go to college. Yesterday, we were discussing the Battle of Gettysburg, and the professor called on me.
Well, what's wrong with that?
He wanted an eyewitness account.
When I went into radio, practically in its infancy, the big stars of radio then was Eddie Cantor, Jason Sanborn, Rudy Valley, and Amos and Andy. And then Gracie and myself, we came to Bill Radio and Jack Benny and Fred Allen. And everybody was in the first 10 all the time because there were only 8 acts in radio. So we're all in the first 10 all the time. All the fellas that were in radio and the women that were in radio, you couldn't keep them out of show business. We'll take Ed Wynn, let's say. Ed Wynn went from radio into television. It was the same Ed Wynn. He was doing the same character he did on stage. Edgar Bergen was in radio, and he did that same thing with Charlie McCarthy and Rockwell. So he took that all with him, and we did the same thing. So I don't think anybody really makes the change. I don't think there's a big change. The difference between vaudeville and radio in material was the fact that in vaudeville, you did the same things every week. You were positive that the laughs were there. Because you had 17 minutes, you knew where every joke was, you knew where the timing was, you knew where they'd laugh. In radio, you didn't. You had to do new things every week. You had to have a good delivery. You had to have a personality. You had to have some sort of charisma, some magic that came through the box.
Where the blue of the night meets the gold of the day, someone waits for me.
You read it. You'd read the jokes, or you'd read the dialogue, and the property man or the sound man would slam the door, he'd pick up the telephone, you'd say hello, and you'd have a phone conversation, and he'd drop the phone, and everybody was working, and you were taking bows. Radio was much easier than television. Television, you've got to pick up the phone yourself. That's not easy.
Hello? Yes? Oh, yes. sure. I'll stay. What's tonight? Yeah, 7?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, sure. Positively. Yeah. All right. Goodbye. Goodbye. Phone number.
I loved all the show business. But I started when I was 6 or 7 years old. I sang with the Pee Wee Quartet and used to pass the hat around. And then I played vaudeville. And I was a small-time vaudeville actor until I was 27 years old. And I was very bad, but the theaters were worse than I was. And finally I met Gracie. Gracie was looking to do something because she was an Irish actress before that. She was working with a fellow called Larry Riley and doing Irish sketches. She was a great Irish dancer and a great Irish actress. And Gracie took a look at us, and I asked her whether she'd like to work with me, and, you know, she said she would. And from then on, I turned out to be a very, very good act, because she was very good. So I made myself the comedian, and I came out on the stage with my hat turned up and a big red bow tie and wide pants and a very short coat, and Gracie came out dressed beautifully. She was the straight woman. And we played Boonton, New Jersey. And there wasn't much of an audience out there, but the people liked Gracie the minute they saw her. And they laughed when she asked the questions. And they didn't laugh when I told the answers. You know, I smoked cigars and I wanted to continue smoking. So I gave her all the jokes. When Gracie took over the act, when she got to be the comedian, I had all kinds of jokes. I had sarcastic jokes, I had wisecracks, and I also had jokes that were off-center, that were sort of on the dumb side.
Yeah, well, I know I'm dizzy.
That's why I like you. I like you because you're a nice little dizzy girl.
Yeah, I know I'm dizzy. I'm glad I'm dizzy.
You're the only dizzy girl that I know that's glad she's dizzy.
Yeah, I'm glad I'm a dizzy girl because boys like dizzy girls and I like boys.
And the audience loved the dumb jokes. And they didn't laugh at the wisecracks and they didn't laugh at the sarcasm because Gracie was a very dainty little thing. And they wouldn't accept that from her.
Romeo and Juliet is a book written by Shakespeare where a man makes love to a girl on a balcony.
Yeah, well, that's just why I didn't read it, because I feel if a fellow can't afford to take his girl in the orchestra, he shouldn't take her to a theater at all.
And she told the wildest kind of jokes. We called them illogical logic. They made sense, but only to Gracie. Those were her best jokes.
They had a pretty girl over there,
didn't they? Yeah, looks like my sister Alice.
So is it
that?
Yeah.
Say,
how is your sister
out?
What was she doing?
Well, you know, she was offered a $40 job, but she wants to save money, so she didn't take it.
So she didn't take it?
No, she took a $10 job instead.
She did?
Yeah, because she figures if she loses a $10 job instead of a $40 job, she's still saving $30.
Well, look, give me a ticket and let's dance. I mean, she's still saving.
And her sense of concentration was simply marvelous. To Gracie, there was no audience, and there were no footlights. That was a wall as far as Gracie was concerned. There were just four walls. And if anybody needed a straight man, it was Gracie, because she'd never wait for anything. She talked natural. You know, when you talk, you don't wait for laughs unless somebody says something, you know, like that in time, which was my job. I wouldn't not with very big lines. My lines were old. Well, I did all kinds of great stuff.
Here's a nice little waterproof number. A little summer number. Do you like
it? Oh, yeah. Say, you know, my brother went in swimming yesterday. He stayed under the water 6 hours.
6 hours?
Yes.
If you stay under the water 5 minutes, you die.
Yeah, I know. He found that out.
He found that out, huh? How do you like this hat? Here's a nice sailor hat.
Yeah. That reminds me of my cousin.
My cousin has a loving new swimming pool. Is that so? Yeah, over there. Yes, we had more fun. We were swimming and diving. Swimming and diving. Yes, believe me, that is a lot of fun. Yeah, and it'll even be better tomorrow when they put water in it. Water in it. Yes, we went on the Rudy Valley show and we did very well. And about a week later we went on the Guy Lombardo show. It was Guy Lombardo and his Royal Canadians, the sweetest music this side of heaven. And then Lombardo left the show and we took over the show, and that's the way we started radio.
George, I can also tell you what you're thinking about. I'm a mind reader. Rita.
Listen, Gracie, is there anything that phases you?
I don't think so.
No.
All right, now, think of something.
All right, I'm thinking.
Is it green?
Is what green?
Does it hang from the ceiling and whistle?
Does what hang from the ceiling and whistle?
Does it run along the floor and sing?
Listen.
Does it climb up buildings and swim?
Just a minute. I thought you said that you could read my mind.
Well, George, how can I read your mind if you keep on asking me all those silly questions?
I'm asking you. Listen, let's talk about something else. How is your brother?
My brother? Oh, well, I think they ought to open up all the prisons. It would help prosperity.
Wait a minute, that's the wrong answer.
No, that's the right answer, but you asked the wrong question.
And when she was about 34 or 35 years old, she said to me, I can't do this character anymore. I'm too old to be that silly. And I said, no, you're not, because if you're born stupid, you stay stupid all your life. You're stupid when you're 1 year old and when you're 10 years old and when you're 80 years old. But your dialogue, your routines have to fit your age. Like when we first started, we did a joke where Gracie had a little whistle. And I said, I'm going to kiss her. And she said,
you see this? That's a policeman's whistle. That's if fellas get fresh or try to kiss me. I blow that and the policeman comes.
And the policeman comes?
Yeah.
Well, go on and call a policeman.
Yeah, well, you're pretty lucky it's broken from last night.
I says, now that joke you can do when you're 22, but you can't do that when you're 35. I says, now you do jokes like you're putting two roasts in the oven, a small roast and a big roast, and the little roast burns, you know, the big one is done. I said, that fits you when you're 35. So finally, I convinced her, and she went along for the rest of her life playing that character. When your rating drops, when you drop 5 points at a time, or 6 points, or 3 points, then there's something against you that night, and that means your next rating will go up. Some big event is taking place. But when you start to drop a point at a time, and a half a point, and a half a point, and a point, you're in real trouble. That means you are losing your audience. And we were then together about, oh, I would say about 8 or 9 years. We had 2 children, Ronnie and Sandy. But we were still doing a street corner act on radio. In other words, Gracie would flirt with the announcer. When our rating dropped, I went to all of my friends. I went to Jack Benny and I said, Jack, I wish you'd listen to our show. There's something going wrong with our ratings dropping. He says, well, he says, you're not doing enough double routines. I went to Georgie Jessel, and Jessel listened and he said, you're doing too many double routines. And I went to Eddie Cantor, and Eddie Cantor says, Gracie isn't laughing enough. Somebody said Gracie was laughing enough. Then somebody said, you better use the 8-ball mic, which was out of style. He said, when you use the 8-ball mic, you had a great rating. But something happened to you after you stopped using the 8-ball mic. So I put back an obsolete mic, an 8-ball mic. Did everything. Nothing helped us. Right? Finally, at 4 o'clock in the morning, I was thinking, I wanted to stay in show business. I loved it. And it finally dawned on me, I says, our jokes are too young for us. We're much older than the jokes we're telling. We're married people. And that did it. And the next show I went on, I says, Gracie and I have been married for 8 or 9 years. We have 2 lovely children. And from then on, we wrote different jokes. They were older, and they fitted us. Our rating went up.
I dropped by to wish you luck tonight, Jenny. I know you're going to win the award.
Well, now, I wouldn't be too sure of that, Gracie. My competition will be very stiff.
Well, take a few drinks yourself.
Was awfully good in the snake pit.
Oh, but Janie, she had such an easy part.
An easy part? Gracie, she had to play a crazy girl.
I could do that with my eyes closed. Janie, I'm sure you're going to win that Oscar tonight.
Are you nervous?
Gracie, I'm as nervous as a bride.
Oh, well, then I know just how you feel. I remember my wedding day.
Imagine getting so keyed up over the possibilities of getting a little lifeless imitation figure of a man.
Well, he wasn't so lifeless when I married him.
And the funny thing is, after Gracie retired, and I didn't want to retire, so I was retired for the 38 years while I waited for Gracie. I said nothing. All I said was, for 38 years, how's your brother? He didn't tell us. Then when Gracie retired, I had to go into show business. And I had to open all the career for myself, which I did. You know, I started to sing, and I started to fool around, and become a monologist, make fun of my cigars, and here I am.
It's the new Edgar Bergen Hour with Charlie McCarthy.
Clip, you Bergens, help me, I'll mow you down.
Made it possible for a wooden dummy to realize Pinocchio's dream of becoming a real live boy. Charlie McCarthy became one of the most popular stars of all, with a little help, of course, from the unique comic genius of Edgar Bergen.
You know, Bergen?
Yes, Charlie.
I've never made a will. Is there anything I can do?
Yeah. Would you keep this down?
Yes, of course.
I, Charlie McCarthy, being of sound mind,
yeah.
Otherwise in a heck of a mess, do hereby bequeath my telephone book of numbers to Skinny Dugan, my pal. And to you, Bertie, I leave all the money you owe me.
Well, thank you.
Also, my pet rat.
What would I do with a pet rat?
Well, maybe to teach him to talk.
I shall see that all your possessions are disposed of.
Well, only if I die.
Only if you die.
Don't go out of your way.
No, I won't. I didn't mean it that way, Charlie, because if anything should happen to you, why, I don't know what I would do.
Well,
no, I just hate to think about it.
Is the thought of work really that unpleasant to you?
Charlie McCarthy caught on in such a big way. In the fact, maybe that they couldn't see him, they couldn't be sure that he was a dummy. You know, because for 3 years I was answering letters, is it true that Charlie is not a human being, that you're talking for both of them? Well, Charlie became famous, so famous that there were many articles with his name on them. We had the good fortune of receiving quite a few awards,
and I am going to suggest that all the patrol members here indicate their vote for you as an honorary member, and a good round of applause for Charlie McCarthy, the schoolboy patrolman.
What have you got to say for yourself with this decoration?
Well, it's a long story, Bergen.
Yeah.
It's a long story. And a dirty one.
Plus, we went to the World's Fair in New York and appeared there.
Well, Charlie, how do you like the fair?
I think it's wonderful, Mayor.
Wonderful. Did you bring Dottie Lamour with you?
Yeah, but
Mayor, come.
You will, you.
Hey, Charlie.
Yes?
What sort of exhibits would you like to see?
Well, I'll tell you, Grover. How about some girly-girly shows, huh?
Oh, no. Some scientific shows.
Oh, cool. Come on, girly-girly shows, huh?
Maybe afterwards.
Well, move me down. No girly shows.
After a while.
Oh, after a while.
Okay. All the girls say he's the honey.
I had my first dummy. I made it from a mask, a Halloween mask, and it worked fairly well as a start when I was in the eighth grade. And that was the beginning of my ventriloquism. In my senior year in high school, I got Charlie McCarthy. I saw a newsboy outside of the high school building, a little Irish newsboy in front of Lakeview High School in Chicago, and I sketched a picture of him in my history book. I took that to the woodcarver who made ventriloquist dummies, and I got Charlie from the woodcarver, in about May, or so early in May, last of April, and I appeared on a student recital, we called it, in Lakeview High School. That is for all the students and the faculty. Well, I was booked on Chautauqua that summer, so I felt pretty cocky anyway, and I knew there was a career ahead of me. Well, I went to Bonneville in the fall, and Charlie was a newsboy, a little urchin with a little beanie on and short pants, and he was selling newspapers. We did this for 10 years, all over America, England, and Canada, and then in the 30s, Bonneville started dying out. So I was booked to play the Helen Morgan Club in New York. I didn't think a newsboy was quite the thing for the nightclubs. I guess it would have worked, but I'd asked Esquire magazine if I could make a dummy of Esky. They thought it was a good idea, but then they changed their mind. They thought they'd rather have Esky be known as a magazine rather than a ventriloquist dummy. So there was nothing for me to do then but to make Charlie the man about town. So that's how we got in monocle, top hat, and tails. When the head of J. Walter Thompson heard that they booked a ventriloquist on the Rudy Valley show, a ventriloquist, he says, well, he damn well better be funny. That was the start. The idea was ridiculous, you know, of a ventriloquist on radio. My own show originating in Hollywood started in about May of 1937. And that was an hour show. It was a big show. And we had Don Ameche, Dorothy Moore, and W.C. Fields, and another guest star every week. Being on the air for 20 years, we had to cover an awful lot of subjects. And Charlie got into about everything that a boy could get into. As years went on, I had to add to the cast. Do rick de gee do de do do. Oh, so de de do. Do de do do do. How do you do? Won't you sit down, like? That's a good trick. Yeah, city slicker. So I created the character of Mortimer, and Mortimer's fortunate choice was that he was the direct opposite of Charlie. He was not good-looking, he was afraid of the girls, he was bashful, and he was stupid, but he was lovable.
Mortimer, do you know the name of the stars?
Oh, no, I don't know their names.
That's Saturn over there.
Oh, how do you do?
Over there is Mars.
Mars, yeah.
And did you know that Mars and the Earth have the same sun?
No, I didn't even know they was married.
Then as time went on, I introduced the third character, which was Effie Clinker. Effie Clinker is a bachelor girl. Her life has not been without love, it's just been sad love. It's just been tragic.
Tell me, Miss Clinker, are you married?
No. No, I'm not. No. Darn it, no.
Thinking of marrying anyone?
Yes.
Who?
Anyone, I don't know.
Well, now, what must this man have to be your choice?
Well, first of all, he must be a man.
He must be a man. And then?
I don't care.
Those were the three characters I used on the radio show. Candy accepted Charlie. Charlie resented Candy a little bit because he had to move out of her room because Charlie had his own room. But they were very good friends. And when she was about 3 years old, she would sit on one knee and Charlie would sit on the other knee. And they would talk back and forth. And she would play along with the thing and it was just fine. So I said to myself, I'm either an awfully good ventriloquist or my daughter's a little stupid. So I pressed my luck and I said, Candy, isn't it wonderful how Charlie can talk? And she says, yes, it is, Daddy. But you do move your lips a little. Charlie's style, our style of comedy, he was fresh. He didn't show respect either for me or for our guests, and that made for the fun. Well, I think the fact that he was a puppet made it harmless, you know. But also, I could say things through Charlie that I could never say myself.
What's your outstanding memory of radio, Charlie? Your favorite guest?
Well, of course, W.C. Fields has to be number one.
I guess he does.
Yeah.
Oh, the fights we had.
Remember when he said to me, come over to my house, I'll let you ride piggyback on a bus saw?
Yes, that's right, yeah.
And I said, is that your nose, Mr. Fields, or are you eating a tomato?
Yes.
Yes, it's W.C. Fields, all right. Uh-oh, can you see him? Well, I can just see a little of him.
Yeah?
I can see him sticking his nose in the door, yes.
Oh, well, then it'll be 5 minutes before he gets there.
Hello, Edgar, how are you?
Oh, hello, Mr. Fields, hello.
Where's the little woodpecker's snack bar?
Yeah, well, now, Bill, I can explain everything about that incident. You see, he was setting a skunk trap. That's what he was doing.
Thanks for the compliment.
Oh, well, I didn't mean it that way.
That's okay. Nevertheless, the other evening, as I was traversing my garden in search of flora and fauna, flora is my cook, you know.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, a likable young lady. Uh-huh. Makes wonderful creatures.
Yes, well, I believe all that, but that's really none of my
business. Well, I was walking along when I unexpectedly tripped, and the next thing I knew, I was prostrate on terra firma, which was not unusual in itself, but the circumstances...
I can believe that, but Bill, let's get back to the skunk trap, remember?
Oh, you mean flora?
No.
Well, I'll tell you, it was quite an experience. Yes. I heard the hospital, clang, clang, clang.
Clang, clang, yes, I remember that.
After 2 days in the hospital, I took a turn for the nurse work. And I took some beautiful x-rays of my leg, 6 reels of them.
6 reels, that's fine. A feature, huh? What'd they find, Bill, in you?
Ah, just I expected. They found my leg was hollow.
Is that
good evening, Mr. Fields.
What are you saying?
I said, good evening, that's all.
Let's not jump at conclusions.
Charlie, I've been telling Mr. Fields that you want to apologize. Now, isn't that right?
Yes, it is. Yes, I do, Mr. Fields. I do.
But I love a little nipper.
Remember how we used to fight, Mr. Fields? Yeah. Foolish, wasn't it?
Remember the time I said I'd, slice you into a Venetian blind?
Yeah.
That was a good one. I think I told her, was it?
Remember how I topped you by saying that makes me shudder?
Who said you topped me?
I topped you.
Why, the only laugh you ever got was a sneer from a disgruntled termite.
Why?
Please, gentlemen.
Bergen, I'm afraid Mr. Fields just doesn't love me anymore, that's all.
Don't tell me I don't love you, or I'll break every knot in your body.
Now, wait a
minute. People often ask me whether W.C. Fields really hated Charlie, you know, and resented him getting laughs and things. There's no truth in that at all. Fields was a wonderful character because he was a harmless villain. It was harmless synthetic hate, and you could see through it. He was a great man to work with, and of course we both agreed this would be the script and we would assemble it, and then of course we would both go and dirty it up or sneak into the toppers that we wouldn't tell the other one about. And sometimes we'd get so far off that they would have to come and give us the sign, you know, 1 minute you gotta quit or 2 minutes. Oh, then there was another one, of course, that you feuded with.
Mr. Lawton,
Charles Lawton.
Hello, Charles. Oh, boy.
You had one fight to do 1 week, and then the next week, you both agreed to apologize. And Lawton says, I apologize for what I said last week.
I remember that. And you know what I said?
No.
I said, Mr. Lawton, I not only apologize for what I said last week, but for what I'm going to say to you today.
Yeah. And then you asked him,
Mr. Lawton, is it true that you played the Hunchback of Notre Dame without any makeup?
The old...
That was a good one.
Yeah.
Oh, there were so many of them, like with Clark Gable.
So you're Charlie McCarthy.
So you're Clark Gable.
Well, I'm Edgar Bergen.
So what?
Between us, Charlie, to what do you attribute your great success as a Casanova? Will you tell me?
Well, now,
come on, Charlie.
Come on,
you can be frank with me.
Yes, I know, but does Gobble tell Dietrich?
I think I've got a picture of one of your favorite lady friends.
Oh, yeah?
Yes.
Well, I had a few there. Oh, Marilyn Monroe. Oh, yeah. Yes, indeed.
Yes. Remember when you were engaged to Marilyn?
Yeah.
Prime Minister Churchill, he said, this is America's darkest hour.
Yeah.
If Charles McCarthy insists on marrying Miss Monroe, I have only this to say. Never before has one so little taken so much from so many. Well, then there was one other girl, Charlie.
Yeah?
Yes, one that really was exciting. Mae West was on the show.
Oh, boy. We went into hiding afterwards?
Yes. When she said hello, it kind of sounded sexy.
Oh, hello, short, dark, and handsome. How tall, blonde, and terrific.
Say, Charlie, do you smell that perfume?
Yes.
Isn't it ravishing?
Yes, it is. It's ravishing. It's weakening. So help me, I'm swooning. What is it?
Well, it's my favorite perfume, Ashes of Men.
Uh-oh.
Ashes of Men? Holy smoke. She's not going to make a sinner out of me.
Tell me, Miss West, have you ever found the one man in your life that you could really love?
Sure, lots of times.
Oh,
you look pretty good to me, Charlie. Come here. You ain't afraid I'll do you wrong.
Well, now that you ask, huh?
Oh, I'm afraid I'll do you right.
Well, I'm plainly confused. I need time for that one, Mae.
That's all right. I like a man what takes his time.
Well.
Come here. I'll show you how to act.
Oh, Mae, don't be so rough. To me, love is peace and quiet.
That ain't love, that's sleep.
Of course, the unusual thing, most unusual broadcast we ever had was, it was at Fort Ord, Northern California. We did the broadcast, there must have been 20 or 30,000 men there. And after the show was over, I do an after show for the men with Charlie. And I was doing a routine, having fun, and they were laughing. And an officer came in, and he says, Company 2248, signature, report to your barracks immediately. And Charlie says, very funny, very funny. So I finished the routine, and anything goes, you know. So it was through, and I said, what was the gag? He says, Japan has just bombed Pearl Harbor. We're at war.
25, now he's hit and hit hard about the 27-yard line. Through the canard, made the attack.
We interrupt this broadcast to bring you this important bulletin from the United Press. Flash, Washington. The White House announces Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor.
Mr. Vice President, Mr. Speaker, members of the Senate, and the House of Representatives, yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
Over there, over there, send the word over there, that the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming, the drums rum coming everywhere, so prepare. So prepare, send the word to beware. We'll be over, we're coming over, and we won't come back till it's over, over there.
Hey, good
job. Hey, good job. All in the United States. These present greetings. Know ye that reposing special trust and confidence in the fidelity and abilities of Charles McCarthy, I do hereby appoint him Honorary Master Sergeant, U.S. Army Air Corps, Army of the United States.
Pardon me. I think I got caught in the draft.
Over there, over there. Send the word over there. That the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming. The drums rum coming everywhere. So prepare, send the word to beware. We'll be over, we're coming over,
welcomes all you servicemen to an hour or two of magic, hanky-panky, hocus-pocus, and humbug. We trust you like to be fooled. We hope we fool you.
USO Cam Show, bringing Hollywood to the boys in the South Pacific. Yes, sir. G.I. Joe sure loves his Oops-a-daisy. Yuck, 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 oh, shucks. Well, look who's here, Bob Hope.
I just want you boys to see what you're fighting for, that's all.
And a jungle fighter shows Bob a trick. Now you grab his hair, Bob. Oh, yeah? A grapefruit has more hair than that honeydew head. The boys love autographs of Francis Langford and Patty Thomas.
Anybody care for an autograph?
Autographs.
Yeah, we love autographs of Francis Langford and Patty Thomas. So Bob dots Colonna's GI.
I got here last night, so I had to sleep in the barracks with the men. You know what barracks are? 2,000 cots separated by individual crap games.
Are. Today, one of them pulled off his shirt, handed me a tattoo needle, and said, okay, make with the autograph, boy. And these Marines stick together and have a wonderful esprit de corps. Esprit de corps, that's a French expression meaning see if she's got a sister.
You know, during the time they stay in boot camp, these Marines have to forget completely about girls. In fact, at midnight, the sergeant goes through the barracks with a flashlight, waking up anybody that has a smile on his face. That, man, you don't? We got it now. Everybody know that?
You're kidding.
Bob liked to do a camp show because the troops provided him with an enthusiastic kind of an audience that he relished. He likes to hear those big laughs, those big belly laughs, sounding good on the radio, you know.
Somebody's flat. Thank you. Don't you stare at me.
I've seen Bob lots of times when we'd be on the road and be up late and traveling and tough schedules, and he'd be exhausted, and we'd arrive at the particular cantonment or military installation where we're going to work, and he would walk out on the stage and get that big burst of applause and those big laughs, and you'd just see him pick right up physically. It was like a shot in the arm. Oh, we were old friends from Vaudeville. I worked Vaudeville with Hope when he did an act with a young lady. I think he was kind of a straight man to the young lady, if I recall. And he did a little stale dance. He was very fresh then, and there's kind of the popular impression of the boy down the street, you know, the smarty, like the wise guy with the straw hat and all the jokes, and the kind of a fellow that's popular in the neighborhood, full of zip and full of beans, and can get away with things that hardly anybody else could get away with because he had a lot of personal appeal. We appeared together on the radio many times before the road, but doing these kind of jokes, which led Paramount people to believe that they could create a comedy series for the two of us.
Well, now that's an idea. Yeah. Where can I get a large package of talent?
Look,
Rochester, Namaste, and yours truly, Don Wilson.
Fred Allen said about Jack Benny, he was the first to realize that the listener is not in a theater with 1,000 other people, but is in a small circle at home. Jack Benny was not only the most successful comedian in radio, he also revolutionized radio comedy. Until he came along, it was pretty much vaudeville with a microphone.
Benny was a new type of comic on radio with a new type of delivery. He was suave and bland and unctuous, where previously probably some of the comedy had been a little baggy pants, a little knockabout. Different, he was different.
I don't think that anybody, a comedian or an actor of any kind, says to himself at any time, I think I'm going to develop a style. I don't think he would know how to do that. I think you just find that innately there's something that you do that you find out works for you. Some comedians talk very fast. They go from one joke to another joke to another joke, maybe topical humor. Now, I discovered when I first started to talk on the stage that would not have been my style. My style was to talk on a subject and stay on the subject.
Mr. Benny, do you think daylight saving time has benefited us in any way?
Well, yes, in many ways. Of course, it has its bad points, too. One is the timetable situation. For instance, you look at a timetable and find that your train leaves at 6 p.m. But when you arrive at the station, you find they mean standard time. So it really leaves at 7. You get on the train at 7 and arrive at your destination, which has no daylight saving time, at 6:30. Of course, your watch now shows 7:30. So you rush to keep a dinner appointment with your girl, which you made for 7 o'clock. Daylight saving time. Then she shows up a half hour later, standard time. And not seeing you there, breaks off her engagement, becomes despondent, and takes poison. So in that case, the only one who benefits by the daylight saving time is the fellow who sold her the poison. Is there anything else?
Now this I found out very early in my career. That's the way I seemed to start years and years and years ago when I found out on the stage. I found out in vaudeville that that's the way I must talk. I found out it was my style to talk slowly, to stay on a subject, to make it conversational and not to make it jokey. We never did anything that we thought was going to last. We never framed anything. We never started anything that we said. First of all, I've never gone to my writers and they never went to me. And it came to me and said, let's make you a stingy character. Let's make Love and Room your theme song. Let's have a feud between you and Fred Allen. See, if we'd have framed all of that ahead of time, it would have never worked out. It always started by an accident. By accident, we wrote a couple of stingy jokes. And then they got big laughs, so we each week or every third week, we would put in a few stingy jokes. And before I knew it, I was a stingy man.
Sure is dark tonight. No moon. Oh well.
Hey, Bud.
Huh?
You got a match?
Yes, I have one right here.
Don't make a move. This is a stick-up.
Sister, put down that gun.
Shut up. I said this is a stick-up. Now come on. Your money or your life? I said your money or your life. I'm thinking it over.
did love and bloom as my theme song. I don't like it today as my theme song. I like it as a song. Then we stopped at 39, because 39 is a funny number. 40 isn't. The feud with Fred Allen started by Fred Allen insulting me on his show, knowing that I was going to be listening. And so I answered him. Then he answered me. Then I answered him. We were in the feud for 8 or 9 months before we even discussed it with each other. That's why it was successful.
Jack Benny handled radio as good or better than anybody, than any of the comedians. Because he knew just the things that he did. He made use of pauses and waits. Like Jack Benny going over to Ronald Coleman's house to he borrowed a cup of sugar, and he went over to Ronald. Well, when Jack Benny goes to Ronald Coleman's house, he goes there, goes down 8 steps, he walks on the sidewalk, and he's carrying the cup. And after that, as the man passes him and drops 10 cents in the cup, and you hear the 10 cents drop, and Jack says, thank you. Then he walks again and walks up 8 steps, rings the bell. There was no hurry with Jack. He knew how to use these weights and knew how to use radio.
Nearly every good comedian has good timing. They couldn't be good without it. Burns has great timing. Ed Wynn had the greatest. Gracie Allen had probably the great, she was the great of all time when it came to timing. You have to have real good timing or you can't exist as a comedian.
Everything Jack Benny did, he'd hold on to. He had the Maxwell car, and he had the bear. I want to get the bear's name. And he'd do things like when he went down into the vault. And he had this crocodile down there, and a man living there for 60 years that never, you know, the worst, but it was fun.
Now, getting back to your expense accounts, I want you kids to be more careful in the future, but I'll pay you off now. Wait here, I'll go into my vault and get the money. Please turn your back. A fool and his money are soon parted.
Oh, it's you, Mr. Benny.
That's right. Take out your gun, Ed. I'm going to open the safe.
Yes, sir.
There.
You see, in radio, you could visualize everything yourself. Like my ball scenes were easier to do on radio than in television. Now, the reason my character sustained over so many years, like you say, how could things go on and on? Well, because I played a character that included all the faults and the frailties, I think that's the right word, and the frailties of mankind. See, every family had somebody like me. Either they had an uncle who was stingy, or one who thought he was very sexy and he wasn't. So every family has that kind of a person. The different characterizations, you know, we made Phil Harris a sort of a smart alecky guy. He either left a pool room or a bar or a girl.
Well, that's about all I can take. I'm going to the bar and start warming up for New Year's Eve.
When Dennis came in, you knew he was always vague about something.
Now, look, now, let's go in the other room.
Well, see, Mr. Benny.
What?
You see this tie I'm wearing? My girl knitted it for me for Christmas.
The tie? What are those things hanging on the side?
She started to make a sweater and changed her mind.
Mary always sort of ran my life, even though she wasn't supposedly married to me.
I'm in my late 30s, or my early 40s.
You were in your early 40s in the gay 90s.
And I would see to it that the material I gave them almost fit their characters personally, and particularly their speaking voices.
Oh, Mr. Bailey!
What is it, Rochester?
I baked that cake like you told me to.
Good.
Oh, Rochester, will you please take these Christmas tree lights and fix them?
Fix them?
Yes.
I ain't fooling around with electricity.
Well, what are you afraid of?
I don't want to get hit by nothing I can't hit back.
Rochester played my butler, my valet, my chauffeur, who had a right to insult me because I was the kind of a fella that was the cause of it.
Hello again, this is Jack Benny, the lone wolf, talking. Can't get a date. I can have a date every night in the week if I want to.
Oh, I didn't mean anything, Jack. I just wanted to start out with a laugh, that's all.
Well, there's very little humor getting laughed at other people's expense. And that reminds me, come here a minute, Don. Did you hear Fred Allen last Wednesday night?
Oh, sure. It was a swell program. It was really great.
Don't review it, Don. Just answer yes or no. Did you hear Allen make those innuendos? You know, those slurring remarks about my violin playing?
Yes, yes, I did.
Pretty catty, wasn't it?
Oh, I don't know. He was just kidding, and you're taking it seriously.
Well, so would Hi-Fest or any other musician.
Well, as I live and breathe and stand under a strong light, so people won't mistake the wrinkles in my face for a washboard. Oh, if it ain't Portland.
I mean Mary. Hope he heard that.
What's the matter with you, Jack?
Plenty. Did you hear Fred Allen Wednesday?
Yeah. Gee, that was a funny program. What laughs? Wow!
Don't elaborate, you little traitor. The way you talk about my violin playing, I ought to sue him.
You ought to sue your teacher, too.
That's so. Imagine saying that I couldn't play Flight of the Bumblebee at the age of 10. I played Flight of the Bumblebee so often, I got the high.
I bet you stung up the whole town with it.
This, I actually remember, started the feud, because the feud started the week before when a little 10-year-old boy played the violin. And when he got through, Fred, knowing that I always listened to his radio show, he made some derogatory remark. He said, to think that a boy 10 years old can play the violin like that, Jack Benny ought to be ashamed of himself. And I jumped on it. And then he picked it on from there.
They want you not to play Love and Blue. Mr. Benny killed Vaudeville. Today, the murderer returns to the scene of his crime. I have the ad right here in the paper, Mr. Benny. It says, the biggest show in town, 14 days only, due to Mr. Benny's prior commitment. You have to put it in there, you're going back with the good humor people. I mean, you have to put it in there. It says the biggest show in New York,
yeah.
You will die laughing.
Yeah.
Now the show is over and I'm still alive.
Yeah.
I would like to have my money back.
If you want your money back, you'll have to go to the box office.
They told me at the box office you're taking it out after every show. I should...
told me I should come to you direct.
Now, wait a minute. 80 cents. The show costs 80 cents.
80 cents.
Now, look what you got for 80 cents. You got the Sportsman Quartet, Marjorie Reynolds, Rochester, Phil Harris, and myself. Now, you did like the Sportsman Quartet.
Very good, very good.
Is that worth 15 cents?
15 cents of anybody's money.
Four for 15.
That's right.
Four
okay.
For 15. Marjorie Reynolds, is that worth a quarter?
Marjorie Reynolds? Let me see. You drive a hard bargain.
A quarter? Yes, I
want
it.
40 cents.
40 cents.
40 cents.
40 cents.
40 cents.
All right, that's 40 then.
Now,
still.
Now, Rochester.
Rochester, very good.
Excellent.
That's only worth 20 cents, isn't it?
Yes, 20 cents.
That's 60 cents.
60 cents.
Okay. All right.
Let's
now, Phil Harris is worth a dime. Is that right?
8 cents.
Okay. All right. All right.
8 cents.
All right. That's 68 cents. That leaves you 12 cents.
12 cents. I would like to have 12 cents.
But I remember, this is my last quarter that I got with me. I didn't get paid yet. I got to have dinner. I got to have a sandwich. I got to have something to eat. I got it. I'm going to be here all day. I haven't even got money to ride home. Not even
tonight?
On the bus. Nothing,
can't
nothing.
Home
no.
Well, how are you going to get home?
I don't know.
Give away about 9 o'clock. You'll never be able to walk here.
Well, if you could just let me have a dime so I could get back on the bus.
The bus?
That's right. That's all.
Thanks very, very much.
One of the most fondly remembered features of the Fred Allen Show in the 40s is Allen's Alley.
Parker!
Yes, Parker!
Hello, Parker!
We've reunited in this studio the original members of the Alley to recreate their roles in a script written especially for this show by Harry Daly, who wrote for Fred Allen in the 40s. The voice of Fred Allen will be impersonated by Al Durney.
Well, it's time for another visit to Allen's Alley. This week, the government announced that it may be necessary to raise the income tax. So our question for tonight is, what is your reaction to a possible rise in the income tax? Here we are at Senator Claghorn's house. I see the senator is home. His team of mules is hitched in the guest room. Well, let's knock.
Somebody, I say, somebody thump my portal. Claghorn's name, Senator Claghorn at it. Oh, it's you, son.
Yes, yes, good evening, Senator.
Son, I got no time to be standing here filibustering with you. I'm busier than a one-toothed mouse in a room full of cheddar.
The Senate has you hopping, eh?
That ain't the half of it, son. This session has the whole Senate upset. Just today, in the cloakroom, I heard Senator Byrd singing the blues.
You mean the...
Byrd singing, that's a joke, son.
I'm sorry, I
keep chucking them at you, you keep flubbing them. Look alive, son, on your toes.
I'll try, Senator. What are you up to these days in the Senate?
A big medical research project, son. My committee has appropriated the money to cure the common cold.
You found a cure for the common cold?
Son, there ain't a rabbit in that laboratory with the sniffles.
Why, that's wonderful, Senator. You've eliminated the common cold.
Not so fast, son.
But you said...
This cure won't work for people.
You mean...
But if you know a rabbit with a cold, you just send him to me.
Senator, our question tonight is about a rise in the income.
Yeah, well, it's got to happen, son. We got the Ways and Means Committee.
Ways and Means Committee?
Yeah, no matter what ways you figure out to keep it, we'll find the means to take it away from you. So long, son. So long, that is.
Now, let's see what Mr. Moody thinks about the rise in the income tax.
Howdy, Bob.
Well, Mr. Moody, you're looking chipper.
Well, every reason I should. I just got a clean bill of health.
You went to the doctor?
No. The vet come here.
You were examined by a veterinarian?
Yeah. He come to look over the stock.
Yes.
So I sneaked down to the barn and stood in one of the stalls.
I see.
The vet's nearsighted. After feeling my withers and counting my teeth...
What did he say?
Said I ought to win a blue ribbon. Didn't expect that one, did you?
Actually, no.
I ain't all rube, you know.
Well, Mr. Moody, what do you think about the proposed rise in the income tax?
Don't mean nothing to me.
You mean you don't care if the tax rises or not?
Nah, I'm always ready for them fellas.
You are?
Every year when it comes income tax time?
Yes.
Every year when it comes income tax time?
Yes.
I drop whatever I'm doing and I go deer hunting.
But what does going deer hunting have to do with your income tax?
Well, no matter what I owe...
No matter what you owe...
I can always send him a couple of bucks. So long, Bub.
Well, let's try this next door.
No?
Well, Mrs. Nussbaum.
You're expecting Mabel Shapiro at noon.
You're all dressed up, Mrs. N. Are you going to a party?
I'm coming from a wedding.
I see, a relative perhaps.
My second cousin once removed on my mother's side. Anastasia Pink is my name.
Did the father give the bride away?
Gladly. You see, a beauty, Anastasia is not.
Then how did they find her a husband?
Oh, they employed the services of a Rappaport, the matchmaker, a miracle worker.
I see.
Rappaport looked high and low. Finally, he found the boy.
And he introduced him to Anastasia?
Oh, not yet. He's afraid one peek and all is lost, you understand. So he arranges that he not see Anastasia until after the ceremony when she removes her veil.
Did the bride wear something old?
Her mother's sneakers.
Something new?
A genuine simulated rhinestone lavalier, compliments of Corvette.
Something borrowed?
The money for the license.
And something blue?
Oh, this is the color the groom is turning when he sees Anastasia.
Well, Mrs. Nussbaum, what do you think about them raising the income tax?
Oh, I'm glad you asked me, because the income tax is leading to the biggest mistake of my life.
Just what was that big mistake?
A vent to an expert's excused expression.
Ah, your excuse.
In the window is a sign reading, Texas prepared, but also free snacks.
So you went in?
Naturally. And over the lox and cream cheese, he filled out my form.
Yes.
And over the borscht, he totaled my income.
I see.
And when it came to the kreplach, he is adding my deduction.
And when he finished...
We held hands through the cheesecake crumbs.
You mean the tax expert became...
My husband, Pierre. Thank you.
Well, I see Ajax Cassidy is home. His shamrock underwear is drying on the lawn.
Here now, who's causing all the ruckus? Who's beating the rigger dude on me anyway? Who's disturbing the peace? Oh, it's you, me boy. How do you do? How do you do?
Well, Mr. Cassidy, how are you?
Terrible, terrible, terrible. I'm outbound with this world. I am suffering from Brannigan's complaint.
Brannigan's complaint?
You see, I owe Knuckle Brannigan $5. Last night he asked me for it, but I told him I didn't have it.
Yes?
He registered his complaint with his fist.
Say, that's too bad. Well, Mr. Cassidy, what do you think of the rise in the income tax?
Me boy, 'tis of no importance to me at all, with 17 dependents.
You support 17 dependents?
I do.
That would be Mrs. Cassidy and...
And the bartending staff at McCaffrey's Saloon. Goodbye to you, boy.
I didn't actually copy anybody in the news for the senator. I had played a character that I called Dynamite Gus. And Dynamite had a faculty of repeating, because you might not have heard.
I say, you might not have heard what he said. We're saying, that is, you know, because it was very important that you hear what he was saying. That's a joke now. Laugh it up. Be alert, girl.
Well, that was my Dynamite Gus.
That's the character that Minnie Pius told Fred about, and he heard it and loved it and made him a senator.
In the alley, I played Tansy Nussbaum. It was a character that I'd played from time to time before the alley was formed. And then when censorship got tight, with the war coming in Europe, it was always there, in fact. He decided on these characters for the alley. And he gave the same woman the name Pansy Nussbaum. Nussbaum means nut tree in German.
Well, I was born old, and I've been doing it. Old men and farmers, mostly, for many, many years since I was quite young. Perhaps you guess I'm from
New England. And he was a small town New Englander. That's what the character was. But Fred had the character that was called Titus Moody. I mean, Titus Moody was Fred's name.
I'd like to interrupt and say that I was playing on the Alan Shaw, the Allen's Alley, a little Irishman by the name of Ajax Cassidy. This phone call one day, man said, he said, I represent the Irish people in New York, and we're going to picket your show unless you cease and desist immediately doing this spoof of the great and honorable Irish people. I said, exactly how many of you are there? Well, he said, there's millions, there's all kinds of, he said, there's a large group, and with, I said, subscribers to the Irish Echo, or the Pilot in Boston, or are you a national group like the Irish Republican Army? Well, no, he said, it's within the neighborhood, there's quite a bunch of us. I said, what comprises this bunch? Well, he says, there's a friend of mine and a widow lady who lives down here. End of riot, end of demonstration.
The alley was an important part of the show, but the Fred's opening was just as important. It was a very important commentary. Then there was the alley, then there was the interview with the guest, then the guest sketch, and then that was the show. I think Fred opened up the whole idea of topical commentary. I think until that time, everybody was depending pretty much on sketches, a lot that had been brought up from vaudeville and review and so forth. And Fred began to mention actual people, actual places, actual events, and to use them as takeoffs for comedy. Fred read 9 or 10 papers a week, and we all read all the local papers, and we clipped clippings that we thought might have some bearing or might have possibility of a joke. He was constantly on the lookout for something in the news.
Earlier in the evening, this telegram arrived from Washington. It says, Dear Fred Allen, be careful what you say tonight. Remember what happened to me. Signed, Henry Wallace. Now, many people wonder why over a week elapsed before Henry was asked for his resignation. Well, the truth is that the president didn't know what to do until he heard from Drew Pearce. Well, enough about politics, ladies and gentlemen. It is nice to come to Minneapolis where things are so quiet and orderly. When I left New York last week, a nimbus of havoc hung over the city. Everybody heard that on information, they always wanted to hear it. But everybody in New York seemed to be out on strike. The stock market went down. Meat was selling for more than General Motors when I left. Meat was so scarce, the city put up a sign in the lion's cage at the zoo, do not throw meat out to people.
The reason they call radio a medium is because nothing's well done on it. A conference of radio executives is a meeting at which a group of men who singly can do nothing agree collectively that nothing can be done. Network vice president is a man who comes into his office every morning and finds a molehill on his desk. He has until 5 o'clock to make that molehill into a mountain. I have just returned from Boston. It is the only sane thing to do if you find yourself up there. All the sincerity in Hollywood you could stuff into a flea's navel and still have room enough left over to conceal 8 caraway seeds and an agent's heart.
Well, Fred, what's on your mind?
I've just finished a picture called It's in the Bag.
Aren't you forgetting, Fred, that this Ifu is in your picture?
Rudy, how can I forget? After all, I wrote that part for you. I'm all set now. I'm staying at the home of one of the big producers at the studio. Rudy, you should see that house. What luxury, even for Hollywood. That guy is overdoing it.
Is it really that luxurious?
Rudy, it's the first house I've ever seen where the mousetraps are baited with cheese souffle. And those furnishings, the rugs are the softest I've ever seen. Why, you sink so deep in them that you can entertain dinner guests in your shorts without them ever knowing it. I stay
Benny's house for a while. That was murder. I lost 20 pounds in my watch the first week.
Doesn't Jack have any food around his place?
Food? The mice run through Benny's house with tears in their eyes, Rudy.
What is Jack charging his guests these days?
Well, $18 European plan, and it's the same American plan.
You mean there's no difference?
No, you get the same amount of food, but with the American plan, Benny hangs a flag in your room.
Fred worked in a piano store in Boston, where he was from. And then he worked in a library, and while he was in the library, he had a chance to read, and he loved reading, and he read so many things, diversification of things. And then he went into vaudeville and did many different acts. He was a juggler.
The world's
point.
Worst juggler. The
world's worst juggler.
The world's worst ventriloquist, too.
Did he do a ventriloquist?
Freddie St. Yeah. James, he took from it. John Florence Sullivan is his square name.
Portman joined him, and the act went so badly that he finally put a flag up on the screen and played Columbia the Gentleman.
She lived for him.
Absolutely.
Yeah, she was a beautiful chorus girl that he fell in love with.
On the show, she was a little girl.
Little iodine girl. Almost a Gracie Allen character.
Almost.
Yeah.
Fred wanted to go into television with a show and a real sadness, with a kind of a show that has become increasingly popular on television. He wanted to go into television with a talk show. But in those days, the rigid formulas were in, and so NBC put him in a show called the Colgate Comedy Hour, a one-hour show with choreographers and dancing girls and everything. And if you remember the time, this was during the Cold War, and it was the time when you weren't to rock the boat. So you couldn't do anything controversial or anything like that, and that was Fred's stock in trade, not controversy necessary, but topical. So he went back and adapted some of his old radio spots, and they didn't adapt very well. When you got them up on the feet in front of the camera, they just didn't turn out to be too great entertainment.
There was a certain type of imaginative comedy that could be written for and performed only on radio. But we are living in a machine age, and for the first time the comedian is being compelled to compete with a machine. The successful comedian is on a treadmill to oblivion.
Television inherited situation comedy from radio. In the 30s, the most popular show of this kind was Amos and Andy. Freeman Gosden and Charles Carell started it all. The program, The Goldbergs, ran them a close second. In the 40s, the top situation comedy was Fibber McGee and Molly. Here's Jim Jordan, who played Fibber McGee. He no longer lives at radio's most popular address, 79 Wistful Vista, but he's about to go back there now.
The Johnson Wax Program with Fibber McGee and Molly. The makers of Johnson's Wax Products for Home and Industry present Fibber McGee and Molly with Bill Thompson, Gail Gordon, Arthur Q. Bryant, and me, Harlow Wilcox. The script is by Don Quinn and Phil Leslie. Music by the Kingsmen and Billy Mills Orchestra.
Oh, McGee, it's Mayor LaTrivia. Hello, Mr. Mayor.
Hello, Molly. McGee.
Hi, LaFiff. Sit down briefly. According to my schedule, I can give you 1 minute and 10 seconds, boy.
I'll settle for the 10 seconds, McGee. I've had it. Good day.
Oh, no, Mr. Don't go. You just sit right here and visit with me a while. Himself here is on a tighter schedule than the Berlin airlift, but I'm loping.
I'm putting the housework on a business basis, LaTrivia. Everything on schedule. Efficiency, boy. You ought to try that at the City Hall sometime.
I'm trying to get several efficiency measures through the City Council now, McGee.
Oh?
In fact, I had lunch at the hotel with President Bates at the Council yesterday to talk about it.
Bates? Oh. Isn't he the man who fought you so hard the last time you ran for mayor, Mr. Mayor? And you had lunch with him?
Yes, if it will help to improve our government, Mrs. McGee, I can work with him. Politics, you know, make strange bedfellows.
How was that again, LaFitte?
Oh, I merely remarked that politics make strange bedfellows. You see...
Did you have to stay overnight, Mr. Mayor?
Overnight? Where?
At the hotel where you had lunch. You said there was a strange fellow in your bed, so naturally...
No, McGee, I didn't mean that.
McGee found a horse in his bed one time. At a Legion convention, Mr. Mayor. But a bed full of strange politicians is worse.
Yes.
You can shoot a horse for the politician.
Please, just a minute. When I said politics make strange bedfellows...
You said a mouthful, boy. You didn't. I went to a political rally in Chicago one time and had to share a room with two fat senators and a ward healer named Beeler. Was there a healer named Beeler in your room, Mr. Bibi?
No, there wasn't. I didn't have any room. I didn't say I had a room. There wasn't any room at all, you understand?
I'll say we understand, boy. The way them hotels ran six or eight politicians into a room that was built for three brooms in a bucket, there ain't room in the room for anybody. How could you sleep that way, Latrivia, with all...
I didn't creep that way.
Huh?
At least that day. Hey! I mean, look!
Now! Mr. Mayor, don't shout! Geez, noise won't settle this.
Well, sir, be calm, boy. We're your friends, Curtis.
Heaven help me.
Now, you said you went to a luncheon, Mr. Mayor.
Yes.
And then you said politics make strange bedfellows.
Yes, but I was...
Tell me one thing. Was there a ward healer named Beeler there? Because of all the strange bedfellows, he snored louder than...
Now, wasn't that a strange bedfellow? A strange bedfellow? A lead fellow? Look, when I said politics make strange bedfellows, I didn't say anything about a strange room full of politicians. Full of politicians. 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 You're the one that said it.
I'd like to ask a favor. The police department pistol team is shooting target practice tomorrow morning. Would you help them out?
Oh, he'd love to, Mr. Mayor.
I'll be there, boy. Hey, what do they shoot at, Latrivia?
You'll find out. Gail Gordon, who did Mayor Latrivia.
Always the same way. Always great.
Kirby McGee and Molly was... There was a lot of fantasy. It took place in a mythical town, of course, called Whistle Vista. This town was mythical, and the street they lived on was mythical. Whistle Vista was not a small town, either. It was a huge metropolis, if we wanted it to be. It was anything we wanted it to be. You know, the basis of all humor and back in the beginning of the theater and so on was the lie.
Mr. McGee, it gives me a great deal of pleasure to inform you that you are now the champion liar of the world.
He was always a liar and a bum, and he had never did anything, never worked, and just a guy that caused trouble. He always got in fights with his friend, and he'd insult them, and he wouldn't play fair with them or anything else. How he kept his friends, nobody knows, but he did. That's what was amazing. And this is what people enjoy. Doc Gamble, he shouldn't have been a friend of a bum like this guy was, but he was because he enjoyed him, and he felt that he was better. Actually, we all think we're better than that guy, which we are, I hope.
Well, for goodness sakes, McGee, look who just came in. Hello, Dr. Gamble.
Hello, my dear.
Hi, Doc. And what are you doing in the magic shop, Fumble Thumb?
If you're trying to find out how to make yourself disappear, please do so and have them send me the bill.
May I ask what you're doing in here, Doctor? Are you a magician?
Is he a magician? You ever see his wizard thermometer? He sticks it under your tongue and pulls $300 out of your pocket.
Look, wobble jaw. I'm an even-tempered man, and I dislike to brawl in public. But a few more of your snide comments, and I shall be forced to throw a few knuckles into your unpaid 14th.
Throw whose knuckles into whose what? Why, you creepy old has-been that never was, you make one move toward me, and I'll stomp your mushy old frame right into the woodwork.
Oh, yes? Don't forget I've seen your muscles, such as they are. And I happen to know you couldn't go two rounds with Margaret O'Brien. And the obligato to Mother McCree.
Boy, Boys. My goodness, after all.
Well, I don't think my character came from me. I mean, I don't think I was Fibber McGee in the least. I think I was the direct opposite from Fibber McGee. I didn't have a dirty closet. I wasn't a liar. I was very... I couldn't tell a lie and get away with it if I wanted to. I don't think I was the same as Fibber McGee. I think I was just a character that I played. That's the way I always felt about.
The bell would ring, and that would be the entrance cue for whoever it was, of course.
Hello there, Mr. Wimple.
Oh, hi, Wim.
Hello, Fitz.
Taking a little stroll, Mr. Wimple?
Yes, in a way, Mrs. McGee. Mostly, I'm sort of a refugee.
Mm-hmm.
Sweetie-Face, that's my big old wife, you know.
Yes, we know.
She's doing a bridge party for a lot of matrons.
What do you mean, matrons? Older women?
No, I mean matrons from the county jail.
Come in.
Oh, hi, old-timer.
Hello, Mr. Old-timer.
Come over there, kids. Hey, what you doing with a rope around your neck, Johnny?
Oh, I was just getting ready.
Oh, don't do it, Johnny. Things can't be that bad, boy.
Randy's just gone to see
him. Well, reconsider, Johnny. Don't be hasty. What if you are a dismal failure in life?
Well, when I was your age, Johnny, I was a failure, too.
Not as bad as you are, but a failure. No, that ain't gonna sell him, is it?
Come in.
Well, hello, Mrs. McGee. Hello, little chum.
Gildersleeve!
Hi, Mike. Nice to see you, Mr. Gildersleeve. Won't you have a chair and a cup of tea?
No, thank you, Mrs. McGee. I can't stay but a moment. I just dropped in to say goodbye. Oh, my lawnmower.
What about your lawnmower?
McGee never returned it. I'm going to need it in Summerfield.
Now, wait a minute, Gildersleeve. You know very well that ain't your own lawnmower.
It is, too. You borrowed it.
It was mine, and you borrowed it.
Boys.
Well, I'd go to answer the phone, or go to take down the phone to get a number, and I'd say...
Hello, operator. Give me the residence of Rockport and keep it...
Huh? Oh, is that too much?
No.
Dear, oh, dear.
How's every little thing, Mert?
And I'd say, oh, is that too much? Well, how's every little thing, Mert? What? He did what? Oh, you beautiful Afghan. Lost it. Well, what happened? Oh, I see. You went back to Afghanistan.
I never thought such a man. You either work like fury for a few minutes or you sit down doing nothing.
I'm a member of the sweater set. I either sweat or set. Get it, Molly? I says I'm a member of the sweater set.
Ain't funny, McGee.
We grew up together. We were young teenagers together in the same town, Peoria, Illinois. That's where we met, of course. And that's where we were married, and then we went into show business after we were married. So go back to the early days of radio, where very few women were able to speak and be heard in life. She had the voice for the... She was the balancing influence that kept him from going to jail or having somebody beat him up. She kept things on a kind of an even keel. Well, the material would come from our own lives, and it would come from the lives of the people on the show. And the more real it was, the better it was, the more believable the situation could be, why easier it was to get laughs with it.
Hey, remember when we were kids in Peoria and I built that big hollow snowman with a tunnel under it and I'd crawl into it at night and talk to people when they walked past? Remember that?
Yes. Yeah. Well, we went on some beautiful sleigh rides in Peoria, too.
Yeah.
In fact, I think the first time you ever kissed me was the night you rented the cutter from the livery stable.
Well, I had to kiss you, Tootsie. You had too much invested to waste the evening. Besides, holding hands is all right in the summertime, but when it comes mitten weather, a man has to establish better contacts.
I'll bet tonight would be a beautiful night for a sleigh ride, McGee.
I know where I can get a sleigh. Farmer friend of mine out on Route 62, Mel Hess. His name is Mel of a Hess, but they call him Mel for short. He'll rent us a sleigh. Well, I'll call old Mel then, huh?
What's his number, dearie?
I don't know. I got it wrote down in a little book here somewhere. Oh, I know. It's right here in the hall closet.
I hate sleigh rides, McGee.
All right, won't take a minute. I'll be back.
Hey, Charlie?
Yes, Turkin?
If you had your life to live over again, what changes would you make?
Well, let's see. If I had my life to live over again, I would make the same mistakes here. Only start sooner this time. Get the point?
Yeah, yes.
I love to spend each Sunday with you as friend of friend. I'm sorry.
Thanks for listening. Good night.